Well, good morning, everyone, and welcome to yet another Glenwood feature. And I hope you're all doing well and keeping safe. And thank you so much for all the comments we had back from last Sunday's feature we did. And many people found it so helpful, the stories that were shared and what Patrick spoke about. So thank you. We're so encouraged that you were so blessed by that.
Yes, thank you very much for your encouragement. So, Paul, how has your week been?
Well, my week, Rachel, has been really good until I came to record this. And when I came in, David said, can I just have a word with you? Sorry about this, but this is what's called where we record the, it's a transmitter for the radio mic. Mm-hmm. And normally, because I'm professional, I put it in my back pocket so it's out of the way. But Dave said, I've been looking at it and it's looking a bit damaged.
Yeah.
So he said, I think, Paul, you're too heavy. So could you put it in your front pocket?
It's a bit of a weight limit on it.
A bit of a weight limit on it. So my self-worth has gone down a little bit, actually.
Aww.
Yeah, I know, it's terrible.
It is terrible.
So, also, as we know, those who are at the Zoom prayer meeting, we've got a special birthday this week.
We do.
And Howard Dobson is 70 on Monday.
Yeah.
It's amazing, isn't it?
Amazing.
So
we're
going to do something I've never done before. And I promise you, I will not do it again. But Rachel and I are going to sing Happy Birthday to Howard. Now, anybody else who's got a birthday coming up, please don't ask us to sing because we won't.
You won't want to either.
We won't want to either. And I'm sorry if it ruins your morning. But we're going to sing. David's going to pitch it off camera for us.
He'll be the only one in tune.
Tune.
So and you might
I don't
pick
know what pitching means either. So anyway. So, okay. Happy birthday to you.
Happy birthday, Howard. I'm sorry about that. I hope
that
the day gets better.
It was terrible. I'm sorry to ruin your birthday party, Howard.
I don't think we're going to be in demand, actually.
I don't think we'll be in demand.
No.
And we're looking at hope, but that song didn't bring any hope at all, really. But we're going to look at hope today. And through our readings, there's going to be meditation as well. And through the stories we've got of people on the front line who are bringing hope to people in great need. And Rob Parsons, then at the end, will be talking about hope and speaking into that. So hopefully this will again be something that encourages and blesses you. So, Rachel, when we talk about hope, what does hope mean to you?
Well, I've been thinking actually this week how incredible it is that while everything's in lockdown, that this well-being space is being built literally as we wait, as we sit. And the builders are back in this week.
They
and so
in.
Hopefully this space will be ready by the time we're back and functioning and ready to go. And I just think to have that space is a very tangible presence of hope that for the greater need that there's going to be in our community is incredible and brings me hope personally, actually. So, yeah.
Wonderful. Mm. Wonderful. Thank you.
So now we're going to go into our reading from Ingrid. Thank you, Ingrid.
Do you not know? Have you not heard? The Lord is the everlasting God, the creator of the ends of the earth. He will not grow tired or weary. His understanding no one can fathom. He gives strength to the weary and increases the power of the weak. Even youths grow tired and weary, and young men stumble and fall. But those who hope in the Lord will renew their strength. They will soar on wings like eagles. They will run and not grow weary. They will walk and not grow faint.
My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but hope. seems to hide his face. I rest on his unchanging grace. In every high and stormy gale, my anchor holds within the veil. My anchor holds within the veil. Christ alone, cornerstone, weak made strong in the Savior's love. Through the storm, He is Lord, Lord of all. When He shall come with trumpet sound, oh, may I then in Him be found, dressed in His righteousness alone. Faultless I stand before the throne. Christ alone, cornerstone, weak made strong in the same.
Thank you so much, Maddie and Dave, for that beautiful song, reminding us again of where our hope is built. So thank you for that. We're going to share now the liturgy. Hopefully you'll have that so we can pray together. Keep us, good Lord, under the shadow of your mercy in this time of uncertainty and distress. Sustain and support the anxious and fearful, and lift up all who are brought low, that we may rejoice in your comfort, knowing that nothing can separate us from your love in Christ Jesus our Lord. Amen.
When all hope is gone, Lord, you are born. When the darkness is complete, you come. When all things are beyond despair, We find you. You roll back the stone and are there to greet us.
Lord Jesus Christ, you taught us to love our neighbour and to care for those in need as if we were caring for you. In this time of anxiety, give us strength to comfort the fearful, to tend the sick, and to assure the isolated of our love and your love, for your name's sake. Amen.
When all hope is gone, Lord, you are born. When the darkness is complete, you come. When all things are beyond despair,
we find you.
You roll back the stone and are there to greet us. Amen. Well, folks, we put the liturgy in because it's a good way to try get people in their different homes to be able to join in with the prayer. It's something that I think is very helpful for people. We'll change the liturgies as we move along. And by the time we're finished, we'll probably have quite a compendium of liturgies.
Yeah, absolutely.
From this point, we're going to be listening to some people and their stories on the front line and hope. We're going to have a reflection. We're also going to have a family praying for us. And so all that will flow from this point.
So my name's Mark. I'm the logistics manager here at Cardiff Food Bank. I've been in this role officially and employed since the 1st of March. Within 2 weeks of accepting that job and starting, COVID-19 took over, and so things have changed and have been a little bit different since. So the role ideally is meant to be managing the complete pathway of food distribution and logistics that come through the food bank. So that's from donated food from the general public through into the warehouse here, where it's sorted and dated, and then through to the distribution centres across the city, which are client facing, and that's where the clients would come and receive their food parcel. So I manage and oversee that whole process. Or at least that's the intention. COVID has obviously added a different dimension to that. Things have changed quite drastically. Normally we would have here between 10, 15 volunteers we could have working here. So with social distancing, we've had to reduce that to about 4 or 5. We can have more if people are from the same household. So that's one logistical challenge, in that food is getting sorted a little bit slower and out. Our driving teams, we would normally have 2 people on a van, now we're down to 1. So there's some of that implications. Also office wise, we currently have 2 staff working from home. So that's a challenging for them and as well for us, because it's all working very differently. And I think that's the biggest challenge, is just adapting quickly to change and logistics that need to happen, while maintaining the service as best as we can for the clients who come and need the food vouchers and parcels. So probably for us, the biggest challenge has been the increase in demand of food banks usage since COVID-19 for a number of reasons. Actually, the traditional reason of a food bank is financial crisis, but obviously COVID-19 has added a different dimension to that as well. So we are having to try and stick to our traditional criteria, but we're also having to be flexible as well and be able to accommodate and try and support as many people across the city as possible. But demand has increased, and so that's a real challenge for us, to make sure that we can fulfill as much as we can delivering this across the city. So one thing we've seen through this period is the generosity of the general public and the people of Cardiff has just been incredible. Food donations, even with the supermarket restrictions, have maintained. We did see a dip, but people are still going the extra mile, trying to donate food and finance to us. We've seen a bit of an increase in that. One community, the Danescore community, recently did a collection across the estate, and they collected just over 1.5 tons worth of food. Financial donations have increased. Amazing. People have just been so generous because they just know that there's a lot of people are going to need food banks. We're also seeing Tesco's and Morrison's are starting to donate food stock to us, which is incredible. Very generous food from them. And we've also engaged with British Gas engineers who are not working on furlough. They're helping with deliveries and also food collections this week from some of the supermarkets. In fact, we're really grateful to some of our guys from Glenwood to being able to support the Llanedin distribution centre on a Wednesday, which is great. So Geraint and Ginny and Deb and Rachel, a few of them have been out to help with that. So that's been really helpful. And others as well. So across the city, we are getting a lot of people helping, because we did lose a lot of volunteers because they were over 70. And so they withdrew quite quickly. So that extra help has been, you know, just crucial to keeping us going. So
Psalm 121. I lift up my eyes to the mountains. Where does my help come from? My help comes from the Lord, the maker of heaven and earth.
He will not let your foot slip. He who watches over you will not slumber. Indeed, he who watches over Israel will neither slumber nor sleep.
The Lord watches over you. The Lord is your shade at your right hand. The sun will not harm you by day, nor the moon by night.
The Lord will keep you from all harm. He will watch over your life. The Lord will watch over your coming and going, both now and forevermore.
Hi, my name's Ginny, and I am involved at the TAVS Centre, which is owned by Glenwood, and it supports the homeless in the city. Over recent years, we've been building our connection with Cardiff Council Homeless Services, and we approached them when COVID-19 hit to ask if there's anything that we could do to help. They have been moving those on the streets into hotels, and one of those hotels was the YHA, and they have 90 residents currently here at the moment. And one of the gaps they had was food provision on a Friday and a Saturday night, and they asked us to help with that. So we approached Ellis, a chef that we know who is currently on furlough, and asked if he would be head chef with a team of volunteers. He said yes, which was the right answer, and he's been amazing. We've had lots of positive feedback from residents and staff. One of the staff last week said to me that his meals are a highlight and lift spirits at the end of the week, which is amazing. We have had lots of volunteers help us with this. Sally has been coordinating it, and we have volunteers come in both on the Friday and Saturday for a couple of hours, and they've been chopping vegetables and just been fantastic with Ellis in the kitchen. And we're so thankful to them and Ellis.
Hi guys, my name's Ellis De Mornay. I'm a professional chef. I currently work for the Hilton in Cardiff. A good friend of mine, Ginny from the Glenwood Church, came to me and sort of inquired about my availability to see if I was available to possibly come and do some voluntary work down at the YHA. And obviously she knew that I was a chef, and you know, I could make things a little bit easier for them. So yeah, we're about 5 weeks in now. Everything is going super smooth. Well, at the moment, there's been certain challenges along the way, you know, to do with social distancing and stuff. So we've had to set up the kitchen that we're working in a way that, you know, that we can sort of compensate for the guidance given by the government so that we can all work safely and, you know, we can provide for the people that we're trying to provide for. We're currently feeding about 100 people every Friday and Saturday. We're doing sort of bulk meals that we can, you know, pack a lot of nutrition into, get a lot of the things that you need, especially if you're not eating a lot during the day anyway. And yeah, so at the moment we've got a sort of structured rota where on the Friday we'll do a sort of chicken curry or something along those lines, and then on the Saturday we do like a spaghetti bolognese. Again, you know, house classics, things that most people like. So, you know, we're pretty confident that we're doing the best we can in that area. A lot of the people here have grown up in a povertized background, and you know, they really need the help where they can get it, I suppose. And I come from a similar background. Yeah, and because of that, that feels really nice to, you know, to be helping out. It's definitely good fun having the volunteers around as well. It's getting to meet people that I wouldn't usually, you know, sort of be in contact with, and people from different professions. I'm learning a lot about different jobs and what people do, and, you know, that's good fun for me. I really enjoy that. I think more than anything is just, you know, encouraging people to, you know, to give help where help is needed, I suppose. Especially in times like this, it's really difficult. You know, for me, it's not so bad. I've been furloughed, but I'm still being paid, which means that, you know, I can free up time to do voluntary work like this. And yeah, just give help where help is needed. Yeah, and it's, you know, it's especially for sort of vulnerable categories of people where, you know, they really appreciate the small things, and, you know, just doing this, you really see it.
The chasm that lay between us, how high the mountain I could not climb. In desperation, I turned to heaven and spoke your name into the night. Then through the darkness, your loving kindness tore through the shadows of my soul. The work is finished, the end is written. Jesus Christ, my living hope. Who could imagine so great a mercy? What heart could fathom such boundless grace? The God of ages stepped down from glory to wear my sin and bear my shame. The cross has spoken, I am forgiven. The King of Kings calls me his own. Beautiful Savior, I'm yours forever. Jesus Christ, my living hope. Hallelujah, praise the one who set me free. Hallelujah, death has lost its grip on me. You have broken every chain. There's salvation in your name, Jesus Christ, my living hope. Seal the promise, your buried body began to breathe. Out of the silence, the roaring lion declared, the grave has no claim on me. Then came the morning that sealed the promise. Your buried body began to breathe. Out of the silence, the roaring lion declared, the grave has no claim on me. Jesus, yours is the victory. Hallelujah. Praise the one who set me free. Hallelujah. Death has lost its grip on me. Ew, I've broken every chain. There's salvation in your name, Jesus Christ, my living hope. Hallelujah. Praise the one who set me free. Hallelujah. Death has lost its grip on me. You have broken every chain. There's salvation in your name, Jesus Christ, my living hope. Jesus Christ, my living hope. Oh God, you are my living hope.
Dear Lord, we pray for your love and compassion to wash over us as we navigate this challenging season. We ask for wisdom for those who bear the weight of making decisions with widespread consequences. We pray for those who are suffering with sickness and all those who are caring for them. We ask for the protection for the vulnerable, for protection from the virus and other dangerous circumstances. We pray for misinformation to be curbed so that fear may take no hold in hearts and minds. May we approach each day in faith, peace, and with hope, knowing that you are walking with us every step of the way. Amen.
Yes, Father God, we thank you for the love you show us and the hope that you bring to each of us every day. Help us to be strong and to take courage and to have hope in your unfailing love. Help us to remember that you have a plan. It's a plan that we are all part of. Thank you, Lord, for the work that Glenwood does in your name and for the way it serves the community of Pentwyn, Llanidin and beyond. We thank you for your vision for Glenwood and the future wellbeing space. We pray that this will be a place where people can come to know you and love you. We pray that it will be an environment that will honour you and bless so many. Thank you, Lord Jesus, for being our Father and for being our rock and for being our hope. Amen.
Amen.
The passage that was read to us a moment ago has an incredible phrase in it. It says this: He will give strength to the weary. Sometimes in life, we just get weary. Many are weary now, full of courage, full of inspiration, but weary. Those on the front line are weary, many of them, in the NHS or in checkouts in supermarkets, clearing our rubbish away, delivering our groceries in our factories, in our offices, who have to be at work, and it's challenging. Life's different. It's wearying. Some parents feel weary at home. With cheer kids just doing that homework every day. I saw a film of a single parent dad the other day. He had three small children in a tiny flat, and this man was weary. Some are weary with worry. What about my job? Can I pay my mortgage? Some are weary with loneliness. Jesus one day said this: Come unto me, all you who are weary, and I will give you rest. And you know the funny thing about situations that we're going through at the moment? It sometimes changes the way we look at both strength and weakness. Because sometimes we think we're in control. We look at strong institutions and we think, oh, they can protect us, and or we can protect ourselves. But actually, we never were in control. And sometimes the things we think are strong turn out to be quite weak. But the opposite happens, and things which seem weak and with not a lot of power have incredible power. The care of a neighbour for a neighbour. The love of somebody daily going into that care home, serving somebody, although their own life is in danger. And we are touched by that. We see the power of it. Strength becomes weakness, and sometimes weakness, strength. I'm captivated by the story of Captain Tom Moore. He's 100 years old now, and not too long ago he had a hip operation that left him a little frail, and he wanted to start walking again, and then he had the idea of walking around his garden on his Zimmer frame and perhaps doing 100 laps and trying to raise £1,000 for charity. Well, you know the story as well as I do. As I speak, he has raised in excess of £30 million. The post office has issued a special postmark in his honour. I think he has something like 125,000 birthday cards on his 100th birthday. He's been promoted by the army. He's now an honorary colonel. And he's made a single with Michael Ball, "You'll Never Walk Alone." And it's strange, isn't it? This old man on his Zimmer frame, full of weakness, a little weariness even, plodding around his garden. And we see the strength in it, and we see the power in it, and we're inspired. And who knows how many more millions, billions perhaps, will be raised around the world as people are inspired to make their own difference, even out of their weakness. Some people have thought they couldn't do a thing. The Bible says when we're weak, we can be strong. My wife and I, Diane and I, had a remarkable experience of that many years ago. It was just after the birth of one of our kids, and Di's immune system crashed. She went through something of a depressive illness, and she was quite ill for a number of years. Too ill even to go to church in the early months. And one day she said to me, "Rob, as she was getting better, could we have in our home a little group for those who are kind of a bit on the edge? Perhaps they're struggling emotionally. Perhaps they've had a faith and lost it. They're just going through a tough time in life. And do you think we can invite them into our home and just share with them and care for them a little bit?" And I said, "Yeah, we'll do it." And I know what we'll call it. We'll call it the Strugglers Group. Neither Diane nor I had any idea how that Strugglers Group would grow. People were knocking our door down to get into that group. Now, our church had lots of home groups midweek, but I remember opening the door one night and there was a guy who just joined our church, a GP, and he said, "I've come for your group." I said, no, you probably need one of the other more conservative groups, the normal ones. This is the Strugglers Group. He said, "I want the Strugglers Group." All we had to share with them was our weakness. I remember saying to a very bright, although antagonistic, young social worker, "You know what, Jill, I'm sorry that we haven't got a better example. We're struggling a bit at the moment. We're not the greatest example of Christians you're ever going to come across." She said, "Oh, you're fine." And all we had to share was our weakness. And we listened to the stories of their weakness too. One night, Jill left particularly antagonistic, and as we were kind of washing up the mugs and plates afterwards, I said to Diane, "I don't think Jill will ever find faith in Christ," because we used to share a little of our faith with them. And I can remember her saying to me, "Well, you never know." It was midnight. I think I was asleep when my phone went, and it was Jill. And I said, "Oh, hello, Jill. Are you in any trouble? Can I help you?" No, she said, "Rob, I'm sorry it's so late, but I was driving home across the mountain. I was on my own, and suddenly I felt this incredible sense of forgiveness towards my family, and I felt his presence." She meant the presence of Christ. "I felt his presence in the car. My heart is physically hurting." She said, "Tell me, will it be like this tomorrow?" I said, "I don't know. You're very fortunate. It's never happened to me." And Jill found a faith that has sustained her down, well, almost 40 years now. She's shared that faith with thousands of people. It was born out of not strength, but weakness. So what's the key to it? Well, the passage says this: those who hope in God get their strength renewed. You know, We were never meant to make it on our own, you and I. It was meant to be us leaning on him. Sometimes people say to me, you know what, Rob, your faith in God is a crutch. Well, perhaps they're right. But perhaps I never was meant to make it on my own. Perhaps I was meant to lean on him. And when I do, when I hope in him, I can draw from a strength I would have thought impossible to find. Some years ago, Catherine Hill, the UK director of Care for the Family, a charity that I work with, was in a London taxi. And she got talking to the taxi driver, and he said that his wife had a muscle wasting disease, and they were desperately trying to find an exercise that could help her. He said, we tried the gym and that didn't work, and we tried Pilates, and we tried yoga, and we tried a little bit of hill walking, and it was none of it was any good. And then one day somebody said, well, why don't you try ballroom dancing? And he said, we did, and she loved it, and we go every week. And he said, the other night, as we're going to sleep, I said to her, darling, something puzzles me. We tried everything. We tried the gym, and we tried Pilates, and yoga, and hill walking, and none of it worked. What's so different about ballroom dancing? And she said, don't you know? He said, no, I don't. She said, it's because you're holding me. It's because you're holding me. And because she knew her weakness, and because she was prepared to put herself in his arms, she became stronger than she ever could have been. And the Bible says that. It says, underneath are the everlasting arms. You may feel pretty weak at the moment. Perhaps you're going through a tough time in your life, as well as all the stuff going on. But you can reach out in your weakness to somebody else and touch their life. Change them in some way. Bring some hope to them. And as we hope in God, we find a strength that is incredible. In fact, the Bible puts it like this. Those who hope in God will renew their strength. They will mount up with wings like eagles. Keep your hope in him. Now, we're just going to play you a little bit of that song that Captain Tom Moore did with Michael Ball that got to number one. Just a little snippet. I think you will love it. And then Paul Francis, our church leader, is going to share with us a way that all of us in Glenwood Church here can really touch people's lives and bring hope and strength to the weak.
When you walk through a storm, hold your head up high, and don't be afraid of the dark. At the end of the storm, there's a golden sky and a sweet silver song of the lark. Walk on through the wind, walk on through the rain, though your dreams be tossed and blown. Walk on, walk on, walk on with hope in your heart, and you'll never.
Well, welcome everyone on this beautiful Friday morning with this lovely sunshine. And I just thought I'd bring you a little bit of an update about the work on the building. Most of you won't know, but 4 weeks ago, the builders were put on stop because of COVID, and rightly so. But they've decided now that they're coming back, and they've got guidelines and safety notices up all over the place. And they've started building again this week. And if you see behind me, they've already taken all the car park up that's going to be needed. They've dug some trenches and put foundations on. And as I speak, they're in what used to be our garage, and they're digging a hole to put the steel frame, one of the legs of the steel frame, through there. And So it's really exciting and to see this. And I also want to thank all those people who've been giving generously to this appeal to help us match this £80,000 that a funder not from Glenwood has said he'll give us if we can match it. So every pound we give, he will give a pound up to £80,000. And you know, in the Bible, there are prophetic words, and prophetic words where people speak out words from God. So sometimes that's speaking truth to power. Sometimes it's a challenge and a warning. Quite often it's an encouragement. But there are also prophetic acts where people take an action as a demonstration of a truth behind the action. So for example, Moses and Joshua realized they were standing on holy ground, and so they took their sandals off. That was a prophetic act saying, we recognize this is holy ground and want people to see that by our action. When we began this project, thinking about it about 8 years ago, who knew COVID was coming? And who knew how important the work that could come out of this building was going to be? So this is a prophetic act. This is a statement that says we believe in this community, God believes in this community, and we want to help you and we want to walk with you. And so when this is finished, lives will be helped and lives will be transformed by the ministry that comes out of there. So please, can you help us? We do need the bricks and mortar to be able to do that. So if you can give, please consider it, prayerfully consider it. And so now I pray that you will stay well and keep safe. And I pray that the Lord will continue to bless you all.
Well, isn't that absolutely fantastic, Paul?
It's remarkable. What
amazing news. Fantastic. Thank you so much to everyone. Yeah. And we keep praying.
We do keep praying. And thank you to Rob for his great talk. We do appreciate that very much.
Yeah.
And on this wonderful note of Thanksgiving, we're going to say the grace. But if you're somebody who is isolated and hope seems a long way off for you, please do get in touch with the pastoral team. The emails on the loop at the end, we can get in touch with Rachel, Dave, so get in touch with them if you want help.
Yeah, please do.
Okay.
Yeah.
Shall we say the grace together?
Let's.
Yes. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ
and the love of God
and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit
be with us all forevermore.
Amen. Amen.
Lord bless you and keep you, make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. Lord turn his face toward you and give you peace. The Lord bless you and keep you, make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face toward you and give you peace. Amen. Amen. Shine upon you and be gracious to you, Lord.